Sharing. Okay, I hope you can see my laser pointer, left side of the screen,
Yes, sir.
top of the screen,
Yes, sir.
right,
Yes, sir.
and bottom.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so if you remember last time, we finished at the point where we had completed our discussion about transcription. Okay, transcription is the first part of the process by which the message which is present in DNA is finally what you call it, expressed in the form of usually proteins. Okay, in some cases when transcription occurs and you get the product RNA, that RNA is the final expression of the information. Okay, and this happens in the case of ribosomal RNA and transfer RNA, where those RNA molecule itself are actually the information which is contained in the DNA. But in addition to that, there is also another set of molecules whose information is contained in DNA, and those are proteins. In order to get at the proteins, the RNA has to be further, translated. And when this translation occurs, you end up getting your proteins. Okay. If you remember when we began our process of studying transcription, I gave you a sentence and I told you to kind of transcribe it in your book and also translate it into your book. Okay. And I told you what is the difference between transcription and translation, in that in transcription, the language which is of the DNA is conserved as RNA because it is still nucleotides or nucleic acids. But when you take the information which is of the nucleic acid type and convert it to what are called as amino acids which are joined together, now the language totally changes. And because of this change in language, you call this process as translation. Okay. So, as we start looking at this process by which mRNA is converted to proteins, let us first look at some interesting aspects about translation, or what you call as interesting aspects of protein synthesis. Okay. So, here are some of the things. Thousands of varieties of proteins are needed by the cell, and they are present in the cell at any given time. And in the same way, the thousands of proteins are also being degraded by the cell, okay? Because, they have been damaged, or it's a part of what is called as recycling, or they are no longer required, and therefore they are being degraded. Okay, so in that regard, we have proteins which are called as housekeeping proteins. These are proteins which are needed by the cell all the time, okay? And then in addition to that, there are other proteins which are needed temporarily, what are called as momentarily. Once their use is done, they are degraded. Okay, so because of this, you'll find that in a cell at any given time, proteins are being made and also proteins are being degraded by the cell. Okay, now if you look at what it takes to make one protein, you'll realize that there are more than 300 types of different biomolecules or macromolecules that play a role in order to make one protein molecule. And this includes what we kind of know as mRNAs, tRNAs, rRNAs, Then there are what are called as initiation factors, elongation factors, you know, termination factors. And that fact that many of them are present not in one copy, but in multiple copies. If you look at the actual number of molecules which play a role generally in protein synthesis, it's upwards of 500,000. So you can imagine how much investment a cell makes in wanting to make what are called as proteins. In fact, 90% of all cellular energy is actually devoted to this activity of making proteins. Okay. But the process is so efficient that if I look at a peptide which has got 100 amino acids, it is made in the cell in less than 5 seconds. Okay. And when we look at this translation, no, you'll realize that you get a feel for the old RNA world, as they are calling, because as I say, in terms of genetics, it all started with RNA as a genetic material, then moved to DNA as a genetic material. And you also see another aspect of RNA, that in addition to it being, you know, what we generally think of as simple nucleic acid, which are information carriers, you get to now see how these RNA molecules play a role as enzymes. Okay, in fact, as I say, the ribosomes which we are going to look at are actually giant RNA enzymes. So, and some of these things are probably things which people never talk about when they, you know, talk to you about proteins and how translation occurs, at least as it is done when you study them in your 10th, 11th and 12th standard. Okay, they'll talk about a lot of aspects of proteins and translation, but they will never give you the speak at you know, this is some interesting aspects of protein synthesis. Okay. Now, you already know by now that as far as the connection is concerned between mRNA and the final product, which is a protein, we know that mRNA, based on the sequence, carries information about what proteins need to be, what amino acids need to be joined in order to get at the protein. But this information, which is contained in the mRNA as a sequence of bases, which are, you know, what are called as derived from ribonucleic acids, and the amino acids, which are going to be linked very systematically depending on the sequence, that for that to occur, you need what is called an adapter molecule. And this adapter molecule is what we call as tRNA. Okay, so this tRNA is something which is very interesting. It's like a kind of a plug. Okay, so this is a socket. Okay, or I should say, let me put it in another way. If you have an extension board, no, this is the one which goes into the socket, and this is the extension board. Then the tRNA sits on that, and on the tRNA there you can put a little bulb or whatever it is, if you wish. Okay, so tRNA has got one part which interacts with RNA, and another part which has a connection with the amino acid, such that there is a kind of correlation between this amino acid, which is present on this side, vis-a-vis the sequence of bases which are present on the mRNA. Okay. So, the genetic code. Okay. So, as we look at these aspects, no, we are going to first look at the mRNA part. Then we'll actually look at the tRNA. Okay, so that's what this is. So we're going to now spend a little time looking at this mRNA and how this sequences code, as they say, or represent what amino acids will be joined together. Okay, so the genetic code. Okay, so because the mRNA is an entity which is being read by the ribosomes, the information about what amino acids are represented by mRNA must be contained in the sequence of bases, which are A, G, U, and C on the mRNA. Okay. Please remember that mRNA is also composed of sugar and phosphate, which is the backbone. But since the backbone is not changing at all as you go from one end of the RNA to the other, the sugar phosphate cannot actually carry any information because there is no variety. The difference is the bases as they appear on the sugar phosphate backbone, and therefore we say that the information has to be present as the sequence of bases on of A, G, U, and C on the RNA. Now, in order to represent an amino acid, okay, as a basis, the information of the which are of the bases which are present in the RNA must in some way be organized in a formal way, as they say. And this organization is what we refer to as a codon. Okay, and because we also know, or at one point it was thought that since there are 20 natural amino acids, there have to be 20 such codons. What do you mean is 20 such signals, if you can say, each signal corresponding to one amino acid. Okay, we now know that there are 22 amino acids. Okay, so with this as the background, people started thinking, how will mRNA probably carry information about the amino acids which are to be joined together? Okay, so the first thought was that each base represents a amino acid. Okay, which means when you look at the mRNA and read the sequences A, G, U, and C, each of those bases represent an amino acid. But if this were to be the case, then all your proteins would have been made of only 4 amino acids, because each of this entity would be able to represent only one amino acid. But at that point, it was known that when you break down peptides or proteins, you get more than 4 amino acids. In fact, you get 20, which means you cannot have a one-to-one relationship between the base, which is an RNA, and the amino acid it represents. So the second, the jump in this information was that the bases are read 2 at a time. Okay, and when they're read 2 at a time, they represent a amino acid. Now, if that is the case, you will realize that if I'm reading 2 bases at a time and I have 4 different bases, then I can technically have what is called as 4 raised to 2, 16 such combinations. Okay, for example, let us say I've got AA, that is one combination, AG, another combination, AU, third combination, AC, fourth combination, then GA, one combination, GG, second combination, GU, GC, and so on and so forth. Because at each place I've got 4 possibilities, the total number of possibilities when I read 2 at one time is 4 raised to 2, 16. And therefore, if I were to read 2 at a time, I should be able to code for 16 amino acids. But this again falls short, okay, because at that point it was known that there are 20 amino acids. So the next jump was that the mRNA is read 3 nucleotide at one time. Okay, now since I'm reading 3 at one time, and at each position I can have any one of the 4 bases, then the number of combinations which are possible are actually 4 raised to 3, 64. Okay, so now the scenario was that I've got too many codes and too little things to code for. Okay, so here it was the opposite. I got less number of codes, more things to code for. That means I've got 4 codes, but I have to represent 20 things. Here I've got 16 codes, I got to represent 20 things. But now I have a situation where I've got 64 codes, but I need to represent only 20 things. Okay, so people got stuck here. Okay, that because somewhere there was this thought that in nature, things would not be of the type where things are left to chance. You know, whatever be the system of coding, there would be 20 codes for the 20 amino acids. Okay, so it was at this point that as people were thinking how probably our body does these things and how things happen in the cell, a gentleman from a very different background, and many of you probably may have never heard of this man, okay, Georgi Antonovich Gamow. Okay, now look at his history. He was born in what is called as old Russian Empire, Odessa, which is now Ukraine. way back in around 1904. And after that, I think he moved to US and continued his science in the US and died actually in the US in Colorado at the age of 64. Okay, and look at the date, okay, August 19. Okay, so today is August 18. So actually tomorrow it's going to be his death anniversary in a sense, ironically. Okay, he had citizenship of the Soviet Union initially and then United States. Okay, now what is he known for? He's actually known for a lot of things, but they are all in the realm of physics. Okay, if you look, alpha decay, liquid drop model, what is called as quantum tunneling, this Big Bang, and so on and so forth. And he is feted with this Kalinga Prize, which is also a very famous prize, and his main fields are physics. And he has traveled a lot. Okay, he had been to several universities, Niels Bohr Institute, which is very, you know, prestigious, Cavendish, UCLA, Berkeley, University of California, Berkeley. And his PhD was with Alexander Friedman. And he had two doctoral students, Alfred and Vera Rubin. Okay. Now, where does he fit in the overall scheme of things? Okay. He was actually known to many of the leading scientists at that time, including, Watson and Crick. Okay. At some point during these discussions about science in general, he, being a physicist, but being a mathematician also, gave his own insight as to how this could probably be done, where you have four bases being read three at a time, and your intention is to code for 20 amino acids. Okay, and his thoughts are shown here, and they are referred to as Gamow's diamond. Okay, so what is his theory? Okay, his suggestion was the code is read three bases at a time, but the order does not matter. Okay, so what this means is, let us say I have AAA, okay, that will code for one amino acid, and likewise I have, if you remember, UUU, GGG and CCC, so they will all code for one amino acid, so you have four such combinations. Okay. The second thing was, if you had something like this AAG, okay, then according to Gamow, whether the codon is AAG or AGA or GAA, okay, which means the order does not matter, that will code for the same amino acid, and there are 12 such combinations when you include all the four bases. Okay, so this is like where A is repeated, another one where will be G is repeated, then C is repeated and U is repeated with all the combinations. Okay, so there are 12 such combinations. And then when you have a single, okay, so this is all three of the same type, this is two of the same type, one different, here all different, then you realize that when you have such combinations like AUG, AGU, UAG, UGA, GAU, GUA, they'll all code for the same amino acid according to Gamow. And since there are four such combinations, the total number of combinations works out to be 20. And there you go, you have 20 amino acids to code for, and you have got 20 combinations. Okay? In addition to that, he also said that the code will be properly, will be overlapping. That means what? I can read this as GAU, that is for one amino acid. Then I can then continue as AUC, that will be another amino acid. Then UCT, another amino acid, and so on and so forth. Okay. So basically, this little piece will code for actually for 1, 2, 3, and actually 4 amino acids in a very short sequence. Okay. So what he talked about was absolute degeneracy and what is called as overlapping. Okay. Now what Gamow didn't know at that time, and many scientists didn't know at that time, is that in nature there were 22 amino acids, and there is also something which is referred to as a start and stop codon. Okay, so when you put that in, that there are 22 amino acids and there's a need for some codon which will indicate start and which indicates stop, there's a requirement for actually 24 codons. If that is the case, then Gamow's theory of order kind of breaks down. Now, because you have to put some exceptions to the rule. Okay. So, even in spite of that, he was actually the first to give an idea of how things might be coded for. Okay. And in fact, initially, without the knowledge of 22 amino acids and the need for start and stop codon, he was absolutely right in a sense. Okay. So, he's kind of a genius how he worked out that you have 20 combinations coding for 20 amino acids. Okay. But then we know that as of today, although Gamow was partially correct, that we know now that the code is kind of partially degenerate, the non-overlapping, the fact that there are 22 amino acids and there's a need for stop and start codon. And now we think differently. Okay, but when nothing was known, Gamow's idea was actually brilliant. And coming from the physicist, amazing. Okay, and this is a common feature. You find that a lot of inventions in biology or discussion of biology are actually triggered by non-biology people because they think slightly differently about the problem biology is facing. Okay. So now we know that the genetic code is slightly different. We know that mRNA is read in the 5' to 3' direction. So when you're looking for how the code is set up on mRNA, you have to read it from the 5' end to the 3' end. Okay. Not only that, you have to also read it as a triplet. Okay. So that is read 3 at a time. Okay. So that is what is shown here. Like I'll read as AUG, then GUG, UGG, and AGC. And we also know that it is non-overlapping. That means the code is never read as AUG, then UGG. It is always read 3, and then you go to the next 3. Not only that, it is comma-less, so there are no gaps, okay? And that it is collinear, okay? So there are no gaps. It is not read partially here, then here. It's always read systematically 3 at a time. So 1, 2, 3 will always code for one amino acid. Then whatever basis 4, 5, 6 will code for the second one. 7, 8, 9 will code for the third one and so on and so forth. Okay. And it is degenerate. And what do you mean by degenerate is more than one codon exemplifies the same amino acid. Okay. And that's why all 64 combinations which are possible are as of today assigned to different amino acids. So in some cases, amino acid might be coded for by more than one codon. That is what we call as degeneracy of the codon. Okay. The other interesting part is that this system of reading mRNA and converting it to what is finally called as proteins is seen universally to occur almost in the same fashion with very few exceptions in a sense, okay, or almost no exceptions, if I can say. Okay, and there is no ambiguity, okay, in that will this code for this or will this code for that. It's almost non-ambiguous. Okay, I put a little star because there are a few exceptions. I put the word nearly, okay. I'll come to why I say nearly as you go along, okay. So as of today, we know if you have a gene, it is read to, one of the part is read as a template. It is transcribed to give you mRNA. This mRNA might be processed or whatever it is. And finally, when it's ready, it will be read 3 at a time to give you the respective amino acids joined together to give you the protein. Okay. And as of today, we know what codon code for what. And you must have seen this picture earlier in your life, in your 11th and 12th. So, for example, the way we read this genetic codon table, as it is called, is that so if I read mRNA from the 5' to 3', and if the sequences say U, U, and U, then that is going to code for phenylalanine. If it is U and U, it will code for serine. If it is U, C, or I should say U, A, and U, it will code for tyrosine. If it is U, G, U, it will code for cysteine, and so on and so forth. Okay, so this is the first base, whatever be the second base, and whatever be the third base, you just read it and you'll get that. For example, if I talk about this glycine, it is G, G, and G. So GGG codes for glycine. Okay. Another way to represent is you go from 5 prime to 3 prime end of the circle from inside to outside. So if I talk about say G, okay, and then G, okay, and then again G, I get glycine. Okay. And remember, GGA is also glycine. GGU is also glycine. GGC is also glycine, as shown. Okay. So, based on this, you know exactly what is coded for by what. Okay. Now, also notice that among this, there are some codons which are referred to as a stop codon. So, UAG. Okay. UAG. UAA. UGA. These three are actually, if they are seen on mRNA, then at that point, conversion of mRNA to protein will actually stop, and you'll get what is called a stoppage of translation. Likewise, this AUG, which is A, U, and G, which codes for methionine, doubles as both the start codon and a codon for methionine. And this is here. Okay, so if I have say G, then T or C or A or G is all codes for glycine. Then if it is T, AA, okay. So now see, this is slightly different than the previous one. Okay, there is no T appearing. Okay, and the reason for that is whether the genetic code is being written in the form of RNA or in the form of DNA. If it is written in the form of RNA as it appears on the mRNA, then you will always find the table will contain U. But if I am representing it in terms of the DNA, which is actually coding for the RNA, then it will appear as T. Okay, but it's one and the same. Okay, and this is another way. Again, see G, G, and then whether it is U, C, A, or G, it will all be glycine. Okay, then there is stop codon. There is stop codon. Okay, there are, so U, A or UAG is a stop codon, and then UGA is a stop codon. Okay. So, and these are things which you have seen before. Okay. And just to get a feel for how this all pans out, you'll realize that in mitochondria, things are slightly different. For example, UGA normally is a stop codon. In the mitochondria, it ends up coding for trypsin, tryptophan. Okay, UGG is tryptophan in outside in the cytosol. It's also tryptophan in the mitochondria. Okay, AUA is isoleucine in the eukaryotic cell, and it codes for methionine in the mitochondria. Okay, so this is why I said that the codon is not totally universal and not totally unambiguous. There are slight exceptions, but by and large, the code is the same as you go across various systems. Okay. Also, to talk about degeneracy, remember, we had 64 combinations, but we had only 20 things to actually code for and start and stop. Here is a table which tells you how many codons are present for individual amino acids. Okay, for example, serine, leucine, arginine have got 6 different codons coding for them, while valine, glycine, proline have 4, alanine has 4, and methionine and tryptophan have 1 each. Okay, so if you were to ask me why certain amino acids have got only 1, while certain have 2 and certain have 4 and 6, I really don't have a straightforward answer for that. But the fact that this is what is there is proved by different experiments where they have actually tested all these codons in terms of what they code for. Okay. Any questions till now? Okay. The thing is, I can't look at the chat box.
No, sir.
Staring. Okay. Now, before you know, we go ahead. What was the evidence that the code is a triplet code? Okay. So a lot of experiments were actually done in order to give a feel for, you know, whether the code is a triplet code or is it something different? Is it quadruplet or something like that? Okay. Now, some of the very interesting experiments which gave evidence for a triplet code was actually done by Watson and Crick, Francis Crick, Les Barnett, Brenner, Watts, Tobin, etc. And what they found is that, if you remember when we talked about frame shift mutations, where we said that if I insert a single nucleotide in a sequence, okay, or I remove one nucleotide, what do we call as indel mutations, insertion or deletion mutations, where I have a shifting of the frame. Okay, I find that if I do very systematically insertion of one or two or three or four, I get different types of mutations. Okay, now one thing which people realize is that if I insert one nucleotide, then all subsequent triplets after that point will be out of reading frame. Okay, it will go out of frame, as I call it. Okay, so that is shown here. Okay, so for example, let us say this is the original RNA sequence here, and I insert one thing between the C and G, okay, where I have inserted actually a G. So now what happens is, now because I have inserted a G, after I read GAC, I'll start reading GG and A, then I'll read CGA, then I'll read CGA, and so on and so forth. So what will happen now, rather than getting this amino acid sequence, when this RNA is being translated, now I'll get the first amino acid sequence correctly, then all the others will be different. I'll have a glycine, and then again everything will be the same, because this sequence is such that when I shift with one, I end up getting one different amino acid, but all the remaining are the same. Now see what happens when I add two bases. When I add two bases, see what happens. I read the first one correctly, GAC, then I've inserted UG. So I'm reading this sequence as UGG. Then I read ACG, then I read ACG, then I read ACG. So now see what happens. After the first base changes to tryptophan, again, I get the same, but it is different from this because it is now threonine. Now see what happens when I add three bases. When I add three bases, I get aspartate, then I get leucine, and then I go back to getting aspartate. Okay, because when I add three, I just have inserted a new amino acid, but this entire sequence here is still intact. It is still being read three at a time. Okay, so that is what they found out, that when they did this insertion, when they inserted one, two, or three, then what they found is that the results that they got was indicative of the message being read three at one time. Okay, so this is what we say. Alteration of the DNA sequence happens due to disruption of the reading frame, and then when you do what is called as three base insertion, then you get almost the same sequence in the end. Okay. Okay. This is aspects which are probably not of interest to you right now. The important part is this figure which I have put here. Okay. So what you end up getting is a protein with a stretch of wrong amino acids, like a sentence with a few words in the middle that are misspelled. Okay, so see the difference here. I have one message here. The message is okay in the first part. Everything else is different. Here also, message is okay in the first part. Everything else is different. Here the message is intact except one word is inserted in the middle. Okay, and that is the evidence for triplet code. What are the evidence for non-overlapping codes? Okay, so here the interesting part is when again I do some mutation. Okay, I do a little base substitution. Okay, so at, on an mRNA at one position, say there is a C, and I take out the C and put a G. Okay, now what do I expect to see? Okay, I expect to actually see that there will be change in one amino acid only, if the code is non-overlapping. But if the code is overlapping, then I might see the effect on more than one amino acid. Okay, and that is what is kind of shown here. Okay, now let us think of the sequence AUG, CCC, and AAG. If the code was non-overlapping, then it would be read as AUG, then CCC, then AAG. And I would get three different amino acids as part of the tripeptide which is coded for by this mRNA. However, if it were overlapping, then the way the sequence would have been read would be AUG, then UGC, then GCC, then CCC, then CCA, and I would end up getting 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, a heptapeptide when I give this for being read by ribosomes in an experiment. Now, when this code is given, I always get a tripeptide. That tells me that the code is non-overlapping. Okay, is that clear? Now, and again, if I were to do a mutation and say convert G to C, then all I would do is convert the initial methionine into a different amino acid. But all the others would be same because the code is non-overlapping. Okay. So when we talk about whether it is triplet, whether it is non-overlapping, experiments were done to indicate all those things. Okay. There is another evidence for non-overlapping code. Okay. Now, you have to remember, when I say it is non-overlapping, all it means is that when I start reading the mRNA at any one point, I'm always going to read it three bases at a time, then move to the next three bases, and move to the next three bases, and so on and so forth. Okay. However, if I have a given stretch of RNA, I can technically actually read it in three ways. Okay. In other words, what I mean is, I can read this RNA from this U three at a time. So the amino acids which I will get will be coded for by UUC, UCG, GAC, and so on and so forth. But I can also decide to start reading from the second U. When I do that, I'll actually get UCU, then CGG, and ACC. Okay, now remember, once I start reading, I'm reading it in a non-overlapping fashion without a comma collinearly. And if I were to do one more shift and start reading from C, then I'll get CUC and so on and so forth. And that we call as a third reading frame. Now, if I take one more step and go to the fourth one, I'll go back to this reading frame, except one amino acid will be less, but I'll be back to this sequence. Okay. So when I read mRNA from different starting points, I am not violating the issue of non-overlapping. Okay, I would say that I'm violating the issue of non-overlapping if I read this sequence, but I read it at a go as UCU, then UCU, and make the protein in that fashion. Okay, but I never do that. Okay, so what is important to realize is, even though we read mRNA in a non-overlapping fashion, you can actually read an mRNA in three different ways, or what you call as have three different reading frames for actually figuring out what the mRNA is coding for. Okay. Is that clear? Have you any doubts about this non-overlapping versus shifting of reading frame while actually reading the mRNA? Okay, so there are two different issues. Yeah.
Sir, so from where we have to start reading the mRNA?
No. What I'm saying is that where it will start will actually depend on the ribosome. Okay. So I'll give you an example. Let us say that if this was AUNG. Okay. So because AUG is typically what is called as a start codon, the ribosome can come in and it will start reading and it'll read it in this frame. So it will read AUG, then UCG, and so on and so forth. But let us say for argument, there was an AUG here. Okay. Let us say A, U, G, and there's also AUG here. Okay, now I have a choice. or I can start reading from this point and start with AEG as a first codon, or I can start reading from this point and use this as a start point, and this is the AEG start codon. Okay. Now sometimes those things happen in an RNA where there are three different reading frames. Okay. And the ribosome will now figure out where to start from based on other sequences which are present on the front end of the RNA. Remember, we have untranslated regions, just like we have promoters for transcription. We also have what are called as signal sequences, will tell the ribosome where to start. Okay. But many times what happens is the signal sequences are set in such a way that you can read it at more than one point. Okay. And that is why this different reading frame becomes very, very important. Okay. So normally, okay, what happens is it is very clear where that AUG is. So the reading frame will start with that AUG. But there are some mRNAs where there are multiple AUGs and there are multiple sequences which will direct the ribosome in different reading frames. Okay. But once the reading frame is picked, then the code will be read always three at a time without comma in a non-overlapping fashion. Okay. Does that answer your question? So it is which
yes,
reading
sir.
Frame will always be dictated by the presence of a AUG in that reading frame. Okay. But the AUG could be present in more than one reading frame. Okay. Just to give an example, if you look at this sequence, no? Imagine the sequence is like this. So the reading frame is from here. So AUG is the first reading frame. Okay. But let us, for argument, presume that the sequence was AUAUG. Okay. So now what will happen? I have this as one reading frame. Then I also have AUG here, which is the second reading frame. Okay. So I can shift between one and the other reading frame. Okay. Is that clear? Does that make sense?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Now, the other thing is, how do you make sure that it is comma less and degenerate and so on and so forth? Okay. The two or three things, you know, one, the fact that, you know, there are frame shift issues that when you take out one, you get a different, when you take out two, you get a different, when you take out three, you get to the same reading frame, etc., etc. All those studies, okay, and also very, very specific studies with different mRNAs which were made in a lab and subject to translation, people figured out that although we need only, technically speaking, about 24 different codons, we have 64 possibilities, and then the remaining 44 also have coding assignment. Okay, and that, as we said earlier, that they tend to code more. There are more than one codon for the same amino acid. Okay, now unambiguity of the code. Okay, which codons? Which will specify which amino acid. Okay. Now, as I said, by and large, the code is unambiguous except when you look at eukaryotes versus, say, sometimes prokaryotes, where different codons are read slightly differently, but by and large, it's the same. Okay. And this experiment, where, you know, which codon codes for which amino acid, the starting of those experiments were done by these two gentlemen, Marshall Nirenberg and Mathai. Okay, and see what they did. They actually make synthetic RNA. Okay, and they made the synthetic RNA, which was all U. And what they did is, once they made this RNA, they did what is called a cell-free translation. So in a cell-free translation, what is done is that you take the RNA and then you take cell extract, which we presume are going to contain all the ribosomes and all the factors which are required to do translation. We also provide all the amino acids to the system, and we try and see whether we can coax our ribosomes to read this RNA to make a peptide. And when they did this successfully, okay, now remember, this is not easy to do. There's a lot of experiments you have to do to figure out which is the correct way of doing it. But once they did it, they found that when they gave this mRNA, they only produce a peptide which contained all phenylalanine. Okay, now the beauty about this is, doesn't matter how I read, in which reading frame I read, I'll always get phenylalanine. Okay, now remember, this is synthetic RNA, and I'm forcing ribosomes to simply translate that. So now the ribosomes may not do it very efficiently because there is no start codon, there is no stop codon. They just do it by chance. Okay, and when they catch it by chance, they end up producing always phenylalanine because all the sequence is same, doesn't matter how you read. Likewise, they found that when they gave all A mRNA, they were able to produce peptide which is containing only lysine. So they were able to figure out AAA codes for lysine and so on and so forth. Okay? And then when they did all G, they found glycine, and they found all C, they found proline. So now they knew at least four codons what they code for. UUU code for phenylalanine, AA code for lysine, and so on and so forth. Then they did an interesting experiment. They made a dipeptide. A nucleotide which contains two different bases, like AU, AU. Now remember, I can read this in one of two ways. I can read it as AUA, then UAU, then AUA, then UAU. If I do that, I'll get a peptide which has got two alternating amino acids. Okay. For example, in this case, AUA is read as isoleucine and UAU is read as tyrosine. So the peptide always contains, UAU is read as isoleucine or tyrosine. Okay. So the peptide which is produced is isoleucine, tyrosine, isoleucine, tyrosine, isoleucine, tyrosine. Okay. Now, if I shift the reading frame, see what happens. If I, instead of reading AUA, I shift, then I get UAU, okay, and then AUA, okay. Now, remember, when I shift this, I actually end up getting the same two sequences, AUA and UAU. So that's why whatever peptide I get will always be composed of two amino acids, okay, and that will tell me the possibility of one of them coding for isoleucine or trypsin, while the other one codes for the opposite pattern. Okay, now see what they have done here. 3 U's, then AUA, then 3 U's, then AUA. Again, now see what happens. If I read it as 3 U's at a time, I code for one amino acid. Okay, but I know 3 U's at a time is phenylalanine. Correct? So if I get phenylalanine, then when the next one is isoleucine and it is AUA, that allows me to assign here AUA is isoleucine. Okay. So they did this very intelligent experiment of making different types of RNA and unambiguously assigning which codes for which amino acid. But in this, they are also helped by another gentleman called Hargobind Khurana. Okay, and Hargobind Khurana was very famous because he was an expert in making synthetic RNA. Okay, so. Along with Marshall Nirenberg and Henry Mathai and the work of Hargobind Khurana, we were able to completely assign the genetic code and how each codon codes for a given amino acid. Okay. And interestingly, for that, all three of them were given the Nobel Prize. Okay, and the Nobel Prize was given in 1968. For physiology and medicine to be shared by Nirenberg, Hawley, and Hargobind Khurana. Okay? Now, Hargobind Khurana is a very famous fellow, he is also famous for other things. Okay? One is for deciphering the genetic code or being part of the team that deciphered the genetic code. He also made the first ever artificial gene and also made a gene which could function in a bacteria. Okay. He also found the chemical which translates genetic information contained in the DNA. Okay. So how RNA messages read. Okay. And for that he won the Nobel Prize. Okay. So born in 1922, I think he passed away. I'm trying to remember when he passed away. I don't remember the date he passed away. I don't know whether I've written it here anyway. Okay. But an excellent man. And another very interesting thing is he was also a partial inventor of polymerase chain reaction, for which also he might have got a Nobel Prize, but he never fought for it. Okay. So, very soft spoken man, but a very brilliant man. Okay. In his own right. Okay. So, what I'm going to do is stop here, because at this point, what I was planning to do is talk about the second part, which is the adapter. Okay, so we have now talked about the mRNA for a while, what it is, you know, what is the genetic code, etc. And then later I'm going to talk about the adapter, then bring it all together when we do protein translation. Okay, so I'm going to kind of stop sharing, go back to my screen and see whether there are anything in the chat, any questions or anything like that. Oh, no questions today. Wow. Aditi?
Sir, actually, I added out. As yeah, about
yeah. Okay.
So, you mentioned that our genetic code is not, you know, in some bacteria, there are sequences, codons which aren't read as same and human. Like
got
you
it.
Gave the example of mitochondrial codon got and you are the cell. So, why do we observe that differences? Is it due to the fact that their genetic material and our genetic material is different? Like they contain ribose and uracil. We have deoxyribose and thymine. So due to something like that, and
no,
their process
no.
is different.
No, as far as RNA is concerned, whether it is eukaryotes or prokaryotes, in both cases, RNA is made up of AUGC only. Okay. So that is not different. In mitochondria, RNA does not contain T. It also contains AUGC. Okay. The difference is because there is degeneracy in the codons, no? Because there is more and more than one codon coding for the same amino acid. Sometimes what you find is this degeneracy is slightly different in between species. Okay. So where a certain codon which is read in a eukaryote in one way, but there are four other codons also which are read as the same amino acid, that codon might be read differently in a bacteria. Okay, and it's probably related more to evolution. Okay, because as we evolve, no, everything doesn't evolve exactly in the same way. Okay, sometimes there is co-evolution which is occurring. Okay, as evolution occurs, it occurs globally, right? So sometimes you might find that in some pockets, things evolve slightly differently than where it that it in some other pockets. So as of today, that's why there are some remnants of that. At some point, everything has converged and it has become one. But there are still a lot of exceptions to that, the fact that everything need not be exactly same in biology. Okay, so this is one example where there are some differences in bacteria in terms of how codons are read. Therefore, we say that the codons are not absolutely universal and they're not absolutely unambiguous. Okay, again, you'll see that remember there are 22 amino acids. When these codons were assigned, there was no assignment for the other two amino acids like pyrrolysine and if you remember selenocysteine. In that genetic code table, did you see selenocysteine and pyrrolysine? You never saw that.
No.
Okay. So the issue was, okay, now the genetic code is set. Now, when this bacteria is going to incorporate selenocysteine or pyrrolysine, which codon is going to read? Because I've already assigned all the codons for everything, no? So it turns out that in certain bacteria, because we have got three stop codons, okay? One of the stop codons in that bacteria is not read as a stop codon, but is used to incorporate the selenocysteine. And in another bacteria, one other stop codon is not read as a stop codon, but is used to incorporate pyrrolysine. Okay, so that's why we kind of are lucky that it didn't collapse, okay, even though we didn't know that. So that is where I say that the codon is not quite unambiguous. Sometimes there are subtle differences, and nature will always throw surprises at us, okay. But what we are talking is in bulk. In most cases, the codon appears to be fairly universal, although we have to remember that there are exceptions to the rule. Okay? Does that answer your question, Aditi?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so, yeah. Any other question?
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, is there any relationship between TRA having three anticodons and like mRNA having triplets?
Like, yeah, there is a relationship. So we will be looking at that when the next lecture, when we look at the features of tRNA, no? You'll realize that how certain tRNAs, because the way the anticodon is set up, they're able to read three different codons in the same fashion. Okay, and that is why they're able to recognize that more than one codon can code for the same amino acid. That has got to do with certain features of the tRNA. Can we see that?
No, I was just asking, is there like a relationship with any evolution, like because we have triplets in
there is the tRNAs which are present in eukaryotes and the tRNAs which are present in certain bacteria are not quite the same, okay, and that's why you find that certain tRNAs, when they see a certain codon in eukaryotes, will carry one amino acid and come, while in a bacteria, a tRNA with that same anticodon ends up carrying a different amino acid, and that's why we have this discrepancy. Okay, so yeah, tRNAs in bacteria and in eukaryotes are different in terms of their structure, and in some cases they also read the codon differently. Okay.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Any other question? Any other question? Okay. So shall I stop recording?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So I'm going to stop.